chairing tonight's event to introduce Elizabeth Mumby.
Hi everybody, and thanks for coming. You know, I think what defines the suffrage movement in many ways are the visual images that we have of it. They were so ahead of the time in terms of the imagery, in terms of the simple statements that came out, the, you know, the deeds not words in terms of the suffragette icons, but the visual aspect was so very important to how we now see them. And there's a certain irony that we don't, in the collective knowledge, know that much about those people who created those imagery. And this is where Elizabeth comes in with her book now that she's going to be sharing with us, to tell us, to explain to us a bit more about who the people were involved in the different movements and some of their ideas. So really important that this hidden aspect of something that we appreciate them for is being brought to life. Elizabeth has worked tirelessly on issues to do with suffrage for many, many years, and well beyond the library here. So I think it's just a really an amazing person in terms of her contribution to our knowledge of the movement. So join me in saying, greeting her, and really look forward to the talk.
Well, thank you, Helen, and thank you to all for coming. And I must say, right at the beginning, that it's very fitting that I am here talking about the art of the suffrage movement, because I really couldn't have produced this book without help from the Women's Library curators and their wonderful collection. And they've been very generous in sourcing the images for me for the book. And as you see, Art and Suffrage is a biographical dictionary which contains details of the lives of about 100 artists whose artwork promoted the suffrage cause. And the book is contains about 100 illustrations, and I must say it's been, I think, beautifully produced by my publisher, and the illustrations have come out so well. And you can see for yourselves what a delightful and varied form of suffrage form of suffrage propaganda this was. Yet most of the artists, who are mainly women artists, have never before had their stories told, though in the 100 plus years since it was created, the artwork has never been so accessible and in some cases so widely disseminated as it is today. For nobody who's recently visited a museum shop can fail to have noticed the quantity of suffrage-related items now on sale. Some are straight reproductions of the merchandise of the suffrage societies, particularly that of the ingenious WSPU. And this was material, items that they sold in their own shops, things such as badges and scarves, notebooks, etc. But others take images created by suffrage artists and apply them to the bric-a-brac of our day. Companies such as the Radical Tea Towel Company, which their name that sums up their mission and their heart is very much in the right place, they've chosen images such as these you see on the screen as a means of selling tea towels, mugs, coasters, cards and fridge magnets. As purchasers, we're buying into the history of the suffrage movement, but once we've placed that fridge magnet on the fridge or hung the tea towel on the peg, do we look at it and think, who created this design, or I wonder what this image was originally intended for? Well, Art and Suffrage provides answers to these questions, for my intention has been to put the art back into the lives of its creators and allow them some posthumous credit for creating one of the most visual of political campaigns. So who were the artists, and why were they interested in the suffrage movement? My researchers suggest that the artists span two generations, really. The older were born in the 1850s and 60s and began their professional careers in the days of Queen Victoria, while the younger generation was born in the 1880s and were still finishing their training at the turn of the 20th century. In an article, Why We Want the Vote, the woman artist, published in the Women's Freedom League paper, The Vote, an artist, Edith Mason Hinchley, who had studied at the National Art Training School in South Kensington in the early 1890s, directly linked the treatment received by women artists in the early stages of their career to their involvement in the women's suffrage campaign. She explained how the women artists, and this is a quote now, student life was hedged about with limitations set by men, handicapping her ultimate career. Until a very few years ago, the entry of a woman student to the life rooms was bitterly opposed. At South Kensington, the scholarships originally allotted to women for the same qualifications as for men were only granted for half the period. The big prizes, the travelling scholarships and the diploma of the college were therefore denied to women who could not do the same work as men in half the time. Some of these injustices to the woman artist have been removed from the student today, but those who experience them are the suffragists in the women's movement. The swift response of the woman artist to the women's movement is no mystery. The difficulties placed in women's professional path make them feminists. Equal citizenship is a starting point in redressing the degradation of inferior status. Of the artists included in this book, most were professionally trained, either at provincial art schools or at London, or sometimes at both, with a fair number also enjoying a period of study in Paris at progressive liberal establishments such as the Académie Julienne or Académie Colarossi. As Edith Mason Hinchley mentioned, there had been strong opposition to women students drawing from life models, but persistent lobbying during the second half of the 19th century had ensured that by the final decade this hurdle had been overcome, and it was no longer necessary for women students to travel to Paris simply to take life classes, although many went anyway to enjoy the freedom of the ateliers there. Then once an art education was complete, other problems still remained, principally, of course, that of developing a career. And this was a difficult prospect for men as well as for women, although it was obvious, as the American woman artist Anna Lee Merritt pointed out, that women were obliged to work with a load of domestic care that no man ever carried. And it's noteworthy the great majority of the women artists were unmarried. They developed their careers by becoming members of a wide range of professional societies, submitting work to the Royal Academy and to the Arts and Crafts exhibitions, as well as enjoying membership of the Society of Women Artists or the Women's Guild of Arts. Of the artists whose lives I have investigated, most would seem to have made a reasonable living, having money to dispose of on their death. Many of the artists rented studios suitable for their work and as a place perhaps to live, and whether through choice or necessity. The biographical entries in Art and Suffrage include addresses, so you can place the artists in relation to each other geographically. For instance, it becomes clear that there was a nucleus of women artists living in studios in turnings off the King's Road in Chelsea. Glebe Place, which is a picturesque corner of old Chelsea, was very popular. Emily Ford's home and studio at number 44 was described by a fellow suffrage artist, Dora Meeson Coates, as a meeting ground for artists, suffragists, people who did things. And personal proximity combined with a coincidence of thought to promote political action. The result was the formation in 1907 by another Chelsea dweller, Mary Lowndes, as well as Dora Meeson Coates, Emily Ford and others of the Artists Suffrage League, which is always known as the ASL, at least for the purposes of being short. The other art suffrage society, the Suffrage Atelier, was also London-based. It was formed in 1909 and attracted artists rather younger than those in the ASL. Suffrage artists living outside the capital either occasionally travelled to London to submit their designs to the suffrage societies and suffrage papers, or sent them by post. Art and Suffrage includes entries explaining the differences between the two artist societies. I mean, that's interesting in itself. I haven't gone into it here today. The artists fall roughly into three groups: members of the Artist Suffrage League, members of the Suffrage Atelier, and unaffiliated others who supplied cartoons to decorate the covers and occasionally the inside pages of the principal suffrage papers, the newspapers. In addition to their own societies, women artists were also members of the mainstream suffrage societies such as the NUWSS, the WSPU, or the WFL. Being self-employed, tax-paying professionals, some joined the Women's Tax Resistance League, which was formed in 1910 to highlight the anomaly of requiring women to pay taxes while giving them no political representation. A few of the art and suffrage artists were militant members of the WSPU, and they were imprisoned and forcibly fed. And when choosing a window to break during the WSPU's window smashing campaign in March 1912, one of these, it was a sculptor, Edith Downing, she selected that of a fine art dealer, which is perhaps a comment on the relation between women artists and the art trade. However, in 1913 and 1914, when art became the focus of attack by some militants, with around 40 paintings damaged by suffragettes in London and in provincial galleries, I haven't found any professional artist who wielded a hammer in the gallery. So the suffrage movement was able to draw on a large body of professional artists for whom Votes for Women had a real personal significance. And this evening, I only have time to tell you something about the work of five, of which the first, Sylvia Pankhurst, is by no means an artist hidden from history. Indeed, at the moment, there's an exhibition of her work on at the Manchester Art Gallery, which is drawn from Helen's collection, I think it is. But her suffrage art is so important to the history of the Women's Social and Political Union that I must give you a few examples, and there may be a few members of the audience unacquainted with at least some of it. But for a full study of her artistic life, I would recommend Richard Pankhurst's authoritative study, Sylvia Pankhurst, Artist and Crusader. I think we may actually consider Sylvia the first of the suffrage artists, because while she was a student at the Royal College of Art, she spent her 1905 Christmas vacation back home in Manchester painting Votes for Women on calico banners for WSPU members to carry to meetings during the upcoming general election campaign. Subsequently, she became a designer of some of the WSPU's most iconic images, the first of which was probably this members card you see here on the screen, which portrays in clear, bright colours the working women in aprons, clogs and shawls whose lives she hoped the campaign would improve. It probably dates from 1906, around the time when Annie Kenney had brought the WSPU to London and in the first instance to the women of the East End. But after Christabel Pankhurst came down from Manchester in the following year, the WSPU did shift its focus from the East to the West End. And the women depicted on the members' card were no longer those that the WSPU wished to attract. The design was then dropped and a rather bland typographical one was substituted. And then by 1908, in the autumn, Sylvia had designed the Angel of Freedom device that was used on bound volumes of the WSPU newspaper Votes for Women and a variety of other items. The one on the right is a pendant that I was very lucky enough to find once in an antique jewellery shop, completely just described as Art Nouveau. I didn't realise that this was in the days when they didn't realise the connection, that I don't think any dealer now would miss it, unfortunately. Three similar angels, two with trumpets and one with a freedom banner, feature on the illuminated address here on the left, as you see it, that Sylvia designed to be given to WSPU prisoners on their release from prison. The first was presented in September 1908. So she was doing a lot of work around this autumn 1908. Because at the same time, she designed this other WSPU emblem, a young woman emerging from the prison gate, stepping over her broken chains, accompanied by a flock of doves. And this, as you now saw in the previous slide, is now used as a suffragette key ring. In May 1909, Sylvia created the scenery for the WSPU's most ambitious fundraising fair, which was held at a roller skating rink in Knightsbridge. The socialist realism of the members' card had now been superseded by Pre-Raphaelite angels and similar imagery. And the design, you can see it here in the photograph, was reused a couple of years later at a WSPU Christmas fair that Sylvie organised. And she designed all these the costumes, the 18th century costumes that the stall holders were made, I think, to wear. And in fact, I did once come across a reference in a letter somebody writing to another saying, oh, about this costume, saying, oh, I shall look such a guy. But in fact, they all look rather nice, really. For the 1909 event, the WSPU commissioned a Staffordshire pottery, H.M. Williamson of Longton, to make china for use in the tea room. And the white china has strikingly clean, straight lines, rimmed in dark green, and with the angular green handles. And this was a range that Williamson offered anyway, and I've seen it decorated in quite a different way with roses and gilt and swags. And although it has got these sharp lines, it just looks so different. Whereas Sylvia had taken this, this stark outline and kept it so clean, just and put her Angel of Freedom motif, which she had designed specifically for that fundraising exhibition in the roller skating rink, so that it was shown to best effect. And each piece carried this motif, and at the end of the exhibition, the china, all the teapots, cups, saucers, etc., were offered for sale, made up into sets of 22 pieces. And many years ago, I bought a wonderful haul of this china at auction, and although the provenance wasn't divulged by the auctioneer, I'm pretty sure I did sort of trace it back a bit, and I'm pretty sure the china had once belonged to Mrs. Rose Lamartine Yates, who held fundraising teas for the Wimbledon WSPU at on the lawn of Dorset Hall, which was her 18th century house at Merton. And you can see it pictured here. You can actually, in the photograph, you can actually see the chap with the boater on the right is holding the cup. I mean, it's as though he was holding it for the camera. I don't suppose it was. You can see that angel motif. I really like this photograph. So as in the early 19th century, when women set their tea trays with anti-slavery china, so in the early 20th, suffragettes who bought these tea services could, like Mrs. Lamartine Yates, use them as propaganda tools, promoting the movement, most elegantly, in a bid to convert their anti-neighbours. Another of Sylvia's emblems is that of the woman's sewer, which featured, as well as angels, on the mural of that Knightsbridge Fair. And the image of a woman broadcasting seed, in this case, his case, the seeds of socialism, had been used by Walter Crane on the cover of Cartoons for the Cause, which had been published in 1896, and was a work entirely familiar to progressives and reformers of the day, such as the Pankhursts. So I think she got her idea from there. And a few weeks before the fair, the image of the sewer had been used to advertise a meeting in the Royal Albert Hall, at which the first Holloway brooches were presented to released prisoners. The brooch had also been designed by Sylvia and represents the portcullis symbol of the House of Commons, on which is superimposed a convict broad arrow. And the gate and its chains are in silver, and the arrow is enamelled in purple, white and green. Around 1912, shortly before she was forced out of the WSPU, Sylvie applied the portcullis design to another WSPU tea service. This is really scarce. I've only come across a few items of it. And it's interesting that 1912, things were really hotting up with the WSPU and all the things, but I hadn't seen it advertised at all earlier, so it does look as though it was made then. And Sylvia's Angel of Freedom design, accompanied by thistles, was also used on china at a refreshment stall at a Scottish WSPU exhibition, which was held in Glasgow in 1910. So you can see just how inventive she was. I mentioned Sylvia's design for the WSPU members' card, and I'll now move on to consider one that is somewhat similar in concept, an image of women with their babies and young children, but they're no longer working class with shawls and buckets. Their attire, purple, white and green, of course, now has a decidedly middle class aesthetic as they stream over hill and dale in the wake of the Votes for Women flag. You may have seen a lot of this design recently, as it's on the cover of Diane Atkinson's book. And I must say, I was sorry to see that the artist hadn't been credited. The photo library it had come from was, but not the artist. Anyway, the design on the original, as you see here, is signed by Margaret Morris, who's now known not as an artist, but as a dancer, the founder of the Margaret Morris Dance Empire, which still flourishes. And she was born in 1891 and was the daughter of an artist, William Bright Morris, and his second wife, and was seen from an early age to be precociously talented. She studied dance with Isadora Duncan's brother and set up her own dance studio in Chelsea in 1911 with the help of John Goldsworthy, the playwright, and his wife. And Margaret Morris and Goldsworthy had what was described as an intense friendship. And towards the end of her long life, Margaret Morris did publish a book called Me and Goldsworthy or something like that, where she sets it all out. I mean, it was very interesting. And Ethel Smythe, who was also rather keen on intense friendships, was one of the earliest patrons of Margaret's dance studio. We know that by the time Margaret was commissioned to produce the artwork for March of the Women, she was already involved with the suffrage movement. She and her mother had given a donation to the Women's Freedom League in 1909. And in September 1910, the Liverpool Suffrage Society commented that Margaret, who was a member of the Actresses Franchise League, was on tour in the area and was devoting her spare time to local suffrage societies. She also put her professional skills to the service of the cause, bringing her youthful troupe, which were called Margaret Morris's Dancing Children, to events, mainly garden parties in support of suffrage funds during the summers of 1912 and 1913. And in one of the, another book I edited, a diary of Kate Fry, a suffragist, she's organising one of these garden parties in Chiswick, and she talks about the Morris dancers, and I did do a double take, but I did it. It was Margaret Morris. These are, of course, merely the surface facts, and without, there are no personal papers to say how she related to the suffrage movement at all. But I do know that at the time that Margaret Morris created the March of the Women design, another close family member was also an active member of the WSPU. For a chance purchase, led me to the discovery. The chance purchase was this set of photographs of the baby and mother, and then standing outside the shop. And I managed to work out who the woman holding the baby is. She was Helen Morris, who was a sister-in-law and also a cousin. They had quite a complicated family. Who was photographed in the autumn of 1910 outside the WSPU Putney and Fulham shop, which was at 905 Fulham Road. She's here with her baby Joan, and who was then about 8 months old. And incidentally, the baby might just have been named for Joan of Arc, who'd been beatified the previous year and was well on her way to becoming patron saint of the suffragettes. Just above the baby's head, you can see that there's Sylvia Pankhurst's Angel of Freedom logo is on the poster in the window of the shop. And I must say, although the sheet music design is so attractive, I can't help feeling there's something of a dissonance between the gentle creatures with their loose frocks in the Walter Crane style drawn by Margaret Morris and the battle-hardened conquerors that Cicely Hamilton's words to the march invoke. And it doesn't appear that Margaret produced any other suffrage artwork. By late 1913, she was living in Paris, where she met the Scottish painter J.D. Ferguson, and who later became her husband. And she continued to paint, influenced by Ferguson's Scottish colourist style while supervising the expansion of her Margaret Morris movement, Dance Empire. And her paintings are held with those of her husband in the Ferguson Gallery in Perth. But when I inquired about their holdings, the archivist knew nothing of her connection to the suffrage movement and assured me that there's no reference to her work for it in any of the material held there. But then in the years after the Second World War, Margaret Morris founded both the Celtic Ballet and the Scottish National Ballet, and in 1972 trained dancers for a production of Hair. So I always thought it rather interesting, the leap from March of the Women to Hair. Now these images, now much reproduced, not least of all on the cover of my book, show the young suffragette unencumbered with children and babies. Here she's very much a modern young woman, as was the artist herself. And the artist was Hilda Dallas, who was born in 1878 in Yokohama in Japan, where her father was a mineral dealer, but he's also renowned as the Westerner responsible for discovering and introducing to the West a taste for Yonezawa beef. And if you look online, you can see that the city has a very grand monument to him there. So, however, by the time he died in 1894, he left his family with very little money. And by the autumn of 1901, Hilda Dallas had come to London and had signed up for classes at the Slade, presumably intending to earn her living as an artist. And it's difficult to find many examples of her work, although I did manage to track down a couple of stories she'd illustrated in The Idler, which was a magazine edited by Jerome K. Jerome. And these are mainly of women dressed in conventional Edwardian style, their flowing gowns showing off their curvaceous figures with impossibly narrow waists. And she also had a portrait included in the Royal Academy Summer Exhibition in 1912, and over the next few years exhibited with the Allied Artists Association and the Society of Women Artists. And she became involved with the WSPU by 1909, and between 1910 and 12 designed these two bold and dashing posters advertising the WSPU newspaper Votes for Women, and in 1911 produced a WSPU Christmas card. I've used, as you see, the left-hand image of on the cover of Art and Suffrage, and there's a rather nice symmetry to this, because in fact, some years ago, I actually bought the poster at an auction in Bond Street and sold it then to the Women's Library. It was before it moved to LSE, so it was years ago. But of course, I had no idea then that I would ever be writing a book for which it would be a suitable cover. But anyway, it was good to be able to use it. And Hilda Dallas designed another poster for this Joan of Arc figure was used on the advertising poster for the suffragette. You see it here, just reproduced on the postcard. I mean, they were so inventive about using it, their designs. And also it was produced as this brooch, again, incredibly scarce brooch. I did find one quite recently, but that was the first one I've ever seen. The suffragette had been launched in the autumn of 1912 after the Pethick Lawrences had been ousted from the WSPU. They took their paper Votes for Women with them, and the Pankhurst set up his new paper, The Suffragette, edited by Christabel. And now, instead of having jaunty young women, we have a Joan of Arc figure girded in armour, wearing the tabard of justice and carrying a pennant bearing the letters WSPU. And certainly all three posters depict women decidedly less conventional than those that she'd submitted to the Idler. The Joan of Arc motif, as you see, was used on a badge and also on this correspondent's notebook. Hilda was very close to Christabel Pankhurst, and she spent Christmas Day in 1912 in Paris with her and other WSPU members, and they dined at the restaurant Mollard, which was a glamorous brasserie a short walk from Christabel's apartment in the Rue Royale. And the evening ended with a singing of the March of the Women, so it was a nice, In 1913, Hilda Dulles contributed the cartoon for the cover of the June issue of the Suffragette, which advertised the WSPU's summer fair, at which Margaret Morris brought along her young dancers. And Hilda clearly maintained her links with the suffrage movement during the First World War, at least with members of the suffrage movement, for in 1918, the London Electoral Register shows her along with Charlotte Despard of the Women's Freedom and Dr. Elizabeth Knight of the Women's Freedom League as a voter. So Hilda got her right to be a voter because of property that she was paying rent on at 144 High Holborn, which was the office of the Women's Freedom League. I mean, it's all these kind of little details that I've had to use to build up a picture, because there's nowhere would you find it written down that she was linked with the Women's Freedom League in 1918. In her entry in Art and Suffrage, I cover something of her later life, including her work in the interwar years, staging plays that promoted pacifism. And the designs for a highly praised stage set and costumes, or at least one of the costumes, are now held in the V&A Theatre and Performance Collection. But apart from this and the survival of her posters, in public collections, nothing of Hilda Dulles's work appears to have survived, and I haven't found any record of it passing through the sale rooms. She became a Christian Scientist, and certainly by the 1930s, and in the entry in her, I say a little bit more about connections there. Now, neither Sylvia Pankhurst nor Hilda Dulles was associated with the two artist suffrage societies, although most of the artists in the book were either members of the Artist Suffrage League or the Suffrage Atelier. And one early Artist Suffrage League member who particularly interests me is Charlotte Charlton, about whom nothing has hitherto been known. Even if her family, member of her family who got in touch with me recently, thought that she must be her, Charlotte Charlton's sister-in-law, simply because they knew about her. But in fact, she lived up north and was the mother of six children. I mean, quite a different character altogether. But I'm afraid that Charlotte Charlton was unmarried, and obliteration is the fate of so many unmarried childless women who have no direct descendants to cherish their memory. I mean, I found this over and over again through the book. Our Charlotte Charlton was born in Middlesbrough in 1866 and was the second of eight children of a man, Robert Headley Charlton, and his wife Janet. And he was described as a coal owner, and his, at this point, in the sort of 1871, I suppose, census, his family, which was growing fast, was tended by a governess and three female servants. But by 1881, after they'd moved to a place called Marks near Saltburn, again up near Middlesbrough, they employed only one servant, which was fewer than any of the neighbouring families, so we get the indication that they're not doing so well. And although he's still described as a coal and iron merchant, his family business had actually been judged bankrupt in 1876. And so as soon as she was able, Charlotte had to work to support herself, and by 1891 was an art teacher at a school in Marks, which is a well thought of school that ran for a long time, called the Towers. And she was now the only member of her family remaining up north, for her mother and father and a couple of her brothers had moved to London, were living in Brixton. And by 1898, she followed them to London and was living at a house in the Terrace at Chiswick, where she remained sharing the house with a woman named Ethel Layton until around 1910 or 11. However, by April 1911, when the census was taken, she'd moved out of the Chiswick house, and this is piecing things together. At the end of 1911, Ethel Layton appeared in the dock alongside another suffrage artist, Marion Wallace Dunlop, and they were both charged with breaking panes of glass at the Home Office. Now, there's no way of knowing what was the relationship between these women, either between Charlotte and Ethel, and Ethel and Marion. But when Ethel died in 1915, she was living at the house in Surrey that belonged to Marion Wallace Dunlop, and in her will she made no mention of Charlotte Charlton, despite their long friendship. They lived together for about 12 years. So in April 1911, Charlotte Charlton was living as a lodger in Hampstead Gardens suburb and didn't boycott the census, describing herself as an artist illustrator, etc., of magazines. On this form, she gave her name as Charlotte Charlton, but for work purposes, she by now imported her father's middle name and substituted an initial for her feminine first name in order, presumably, to make the less gender-specific signature more acceptable to commissioning editors. So she was now known as C. Headley Charlton, and she certainly fooled Simon Hoof, who was the author of the Dictionary of 19th Century British Book Illustrators and Caricaturists, which was published in 1996, and which he writes of C. Headley Charlton that he contributed drawings of children in a poster style to Punch in 1908. As far as I can discover, Punch only did publish one of her cartoons, but it does have a suffrage angle. It's a boy is smoking a cigarette and he is addressed by a little girl, and she says, "We'll catch it, you dreadful boy." And he, "That's all you know, Miss Clever. Ma's out with the suffragettes. The policeman's all after Ma, and Pa's hiding in the House of Commons." Faint note on the back of the original, it's in the British Library, on the back of the original, the cartoon reveals that Charlotte had received a guinea for the work, and that the address she gave was the Lyceum Club, Piccadilly. This was a haunt of feminists. By this time, C. Headley Charlton's allusion to suffragettes came not from a casual reading of the newspapers, but from her personal experience. As an early member of the Artists' Suffrage League, she contributed with Mary Lands and Dora Meeson Coates to Cicely Hamilton's Beware, a Warning to Suffragists, which was published in March 1908. By the following month, she'd also produced a postcard for the Artists' Suffrage League. It's called The Cry of the Children. It's one of the more, I mean, it's not common by any means, but it's the most more common of her work. And this other one you see here on the right is actually very rare. It's a little girl sitting up in bed, and she's saying, "I pray for all the grown-ups, wherever they may be, what's done one teeny-weeny thing to get a vote for me. When I'm old, I'll use it. I'm neither rich nor clever, but I can give them lots of love forever and ever." And in 1909, again with Mary Lowndes and Dora Meeson Coates, she contributed illustrations to the ABC of Politics for Women Politicians, which was published by the Artists' Suffrage League. Her style throughout is attractively Art Nouveau-ish, particularly in the repetition of the rose device. You see it here on the counterpane, which this kind of device had been popularised by Margaret McIntosh at Glasgow School. The infants and young women who carry Charlton's suffrage messages are somewhat reminiscent of the work of, at least I think they are, of Charles Robinson. I mean, I grew up with his edition of Robert Louis Stevenson's poems, and they look very familiar. Anyway, there's no evidence of C. Headley Charlton's work for the Artists' Suffrage League after about 1909 or 10, but at the end of 1912, she was still in touch with the suffrage movement, advertising suffrage cards and hand-coloured calendars in the then UWS paper, The Common Cause. A year later, that's in 1913, when she advertised specimen designs for Christmas cards in a December issue of Votes for Women. She gave her address as 28 Glebe Place, which was the home of Cicely Hamilton. And during the First World War, when she wrote to Edith Craig, stage designer, daughter of Edith Terry. Her postcard carried that same printed address, Ellen Terry. Her postcard carried that same printed address, and the card is undated, but it reads, "Dear Miss Craig, Evie said you were good enough to tell her you would try and sell some of my cosy dolls." The National Union, that's the National Union of Women's Suffrage Society's secretary, wrote to say her ladies did not consider them pretty enough for children's toys. "So I picked the pattern to pieces and mean to work it out after Christmas when I have more time. I don't think I'm superior enough for the National Union. They also think the words on this card wicked, and I'm spending the whole of every day colouring cards. Lots of work, no pay worth speaking of. Very many thanks, CHC." Although we know so little of her, it would be safe to conjecture that Charlotte Charlotte Charlton had a modern sense of humour. The printed card to accompany this, illustrated in her distinctive style, shows three children poking their heads over a wall, and the printed message, which was obviously considered by the NUWSS Secretary Wicked, runs, "When I'm big, I'll buy a gun, and so will Babs and Sue. We'll dead those Germans, every one. We'll dead the Kaiser, too." There's no indication as to how Charlotte Hedley Charlton made a living after the suffrage years. She was a very competent and attractive artist, but appears to have illustrated no books. She must have sold some work, which are lying now forgotten, perhaps in magazines. And if so, it may in future be retrieved. I mean, with all the digitisation going on, perhaps we artists like her will surface. She spent her final years in Brighton, living close to one of her sisters. And when she died in 1945, she did leave just over £1,000. So as she started off with nothing, she must have made some money. But elusive as ever, she left no will. So it's been I've been unable to trace any friendship circle that she might have been part of. But that's you must all get to work and uncover more about these people. Another artist whose work focuses on the image of the child is something of a coup for art and suffrage, at least I think it is. For although her work is quite well known, I don't think this artist, Susan Beatrice Pierce, has previously been identified as a suffrage artist. Instead, she is remembered as the illustrator for 30 years of the Amelia Ann series, which began in 1920 with Amelia Ann and the Green Umbrella. I don't know if any of you remember those, I certainly do. She also designed the evocative advertisement that Startright used for decades to promote their children's shoes. Now, I got onto her trail by wondering who was the artist suffrage league annual report, which held in the library here for 1910, was referring to when it commented that Miss Pierce's charming Christmas card in colour was very successfully reproduced by Carl Henschel. He was a very prominent printer, and has been much liked and has had a large sale. The same report mentioned that a Santa Claus Christmas card was sent by the League to each of the newly returned MPs, that was after the election at the end of 1910, who declared himself in favour of women's suffrage. And a printed copy of this unattributed Santa card is held in the Mary Lyons album here in the Women's Library. And I think you'll agree, you don't dare disagree, that the faces of the children in the Santa Claus card are by the same hand as those on the picture on the right, and are the work, which the one on the right is definitely the work of Beatrice Pierce. Surely she must have been the artist suffrage league, Miss Pierce. She was born in Kennington in 1878 and was one of the several children of William Pierce, a shorthand writer and journalist, and he died, I mean, so many of the artist's fathers did when she was young, and her mother then had to work. She worked as a needlewoman to support her family. And after leaving school, Beatrice studied at the New Cross Art School from 1897 to 1901, and in 1900 won a silver medal for drawings of children's subjects in the National Competition for Art Schools. In 1902, she moved to the Royal College of Art, where she studied until 1904, specialising in watercolour painting before becoming an illustrator of children's books. And it would seem that she came into contact with the Artist Suffrage League during the course of 1909-10, perhaps through her friendship with one of its members, called Clara Billing, for by then both of them were living in a very small village in Berkshire, Blueberry, which was popular with artists sympathetic in the suffrage cause. There were several other members of the artist societies who lived there. And the design for the Artist Suffrage League New Year card, which was published at the end of 1912, so New Year 1913, is again unsigned, but is very similar in layout to the Santa Claus card, with a decorative edging along the top and down one side. And it was also issued as a calendar. There would seem little doubt that the lovely illustration can be attributed to Beatrice Pierce. I've compared the faces of the children on these two ASL designs with those she drew and painted to illustrate charming editions of Dickens's The Magic Fishbone, The Trial of William Tinkling, and Captain Boldheart and the Latin Grammar Master, which were all published by Constable around 1911-12. And in addition to the style, the clear and bright colours used in the book illustrations are very similar to those on the ASL cards. Indeed, the commission for the Artist Suffrage League and for Constable may well have overlapped. There are no other surviving Artist Suffrage League items that are conspicuously the work of this artist. I mean, she is so accomplished. And there doesn't appear to be any printed evidence of her involvement with any other type of suffrage activity, although it's not to say that none took place. When she died in 1980, her Times obituaries commented, "Throughout her life, her slight and rather frail appearance belied a rebellious, independent and impish spirit, full of energy and vitality, wit and good humour. She had a wanderlust too and took herself off to such places as India, Florida and Egypt." Well, I think rebellious, independent, impish spirit. I think she is an artist, suffrage league artist. And she was 101 when she died, after a very successful career as an illustrator and her work appearing on posters, Christmas cards and postcards, as well as in books and annuals. But she'd been quite forgotten as a suffrage artist, so I'm pleased that I've been able to resurrect her in this capacity. Now, it's difficult to know, apart from obvious clusters such as those in Glebe Place and indeed in Blueberry, how cohesive the suffrage artists were as a group and whether they stayed in touch once the suffrage campaign had ended. In their biographical entries, I've highlighted instances where the paths of the artists would have crossed in the years before and after they became involved with Votes for Women. But there's virtually no primary source material, such as letters or diaries, to reveal anything of the networks in which they moved. Even the wills, in most cases the only documents extant that give any information on the lives of these artists, are peculiarly reticent, most making no reference to friendship circles and very few mentioning artworks. I must say, I did find this disappointing. I did get wills for every one of them and hoped, as I'd done in the previous book, with the Suffrage Movement, a reference guide, you could see that women stayed in contact right through the rest of their lives. But these artists, I couldn't see this. Most of the women artists remained unmarried, but except for the companionships of, for example, Mary Lowndes and Barbara Forbes and Hope Joseph and Ethel Willis, and the friendship between Marion Wallace Dunlop and Edith Downing, there's little evidence of camaraderie surviving the suffrage campaign. Although as many were members of the same artistic organisations, such as the Society of Women Artists, some contact was obviously inevitable. And so I have found an occasion where they've been giving exhibitions in the 30s. However, no woman artist seems to have been a member of the Suffragette Fellowship, which was formed in the interwar years to keep alight the suffragette flame, nor is there evidence that any were actively associated with other pressure groups or political campaigns. Thus, involvement in the women's suffrage campaign appears to be an anomaly in these artists' lives, the one struggle in which they felt compelled to take part. And although, in general, their work is little known today, roughly a third of the art and suffrage artists have at least one artwork in a public collection, albeit the result more usually of a gift than a purchase. However, only in the case of Annie Swinnerton is there any evidence of a concerted, or call a matronage, that is, of women friends ensuring that the works of a woman artist were left to a public collection. In this case, they were left by various friends to the Manchester City Art Gallery in order that a significant collection could be built up, and it's borne fruit now. Well, she died in the 30s, so 80 years later, it's had the desired effect, and there's a major exhibition of her work on at the moment. And a single work is likely, and as likely as not, it's never going to be on display, does nothing towards creating a reputation, and is even less likely to when the work is misattributed. For instance, I pointed out some time ago to the North Hertfordshire Museum that several paintings in their collection were not the work of a presumably male artist, the unknown Joseph Hope, but of Hope Joseph, who was the founder of the Suffrage Atelier. And I checked back yesterday on you know, the Art UK site, I mean, a really important site, and I see they're still misattributed, so in spite of me having pointed this out. So such is the fate of the woman artist. All in all, the artists of the women's suffrage movement were well-trained, professional career women, for many of whom the evidence of their mainstream work has all but disappeared. What remains are the images they have created while engaged in the struggle to win the vote for women. And it's through these that a century later we're able to access, however superficially, so many hitherto unregarded lives. My hope is that by bringing their names into the public domain, art and suffrage will begin a gradual recovery of lost art and of the lost artists.
Thank you so much. We don't have very long, so should we take a few questions together? Maybe starting there.
It's not so much related to the actual artist, but why were those specific colours chosen? Green, white and...
Well, they were the red, white, the green, white and purple, white and green were chosen by Emmeline Pethick Lawrence in the summer of 1908, particularly to address a big procession that they were going to do. And I rather think that she looked at probably a vase or something, you know, flowers and leaves, and thought, oh, those colours look good together, so we choose the purple, white and green. And then they were given a gloss, you know, rather, she was very soulful in the Pethick Lawrence. She sort of gave it a gloss, you know, white for purity, purple for dignity, and green for whatever. And yeah, so it was, and the colours of the NUWSS are red, white and green, and they chose those deliberately because those were the colours of the Italian Risorgimento, and the ones who have been campaigning since the 1860s, like Millicent Fawcett, were great supporters of Garibaldi and Mazzini, and so that's how their colours go. All the other suffrage societies then chose their colours, but I think most of them just, you know, colours that look good together, and there would be some perhaps reason, but anyway, in my reference guide under C for colours, you can get the list of all the colours.
Thank you very much. That was a really interesting talk. You made a connection with Walter Crane, which made me think of William Morris, as well as obviously the other Morris, who I presume isn't connected. No. But I wondered, what about May Morris? Was May Morris
May
involved?
May Morris has an entry, yes. She did. I think the only thing I particularly attribute to, there was a banner she did for the Fabian Society. So she was connected, yes.
There's a whole load here. Should we start at the front and then go back?
Thank you. I just wondered, did the artists choose to work for or illustrate for, you know, the different women's suffrage movements, or did the movements ask them? And if so, was there any discernible difference in style according to the different suffrage movements?
Well, NUWSS worked with the Constitutional Society worked mainly with the Artists' Suffrage League, and the Suffrage Atelier worked particularly with the Women's Freedom League, the slightly more militant one. The WSPU, on the whole, had its own cartoonists and artists, the styles between the Artists' Suffrage League and the Suffrage Atelier were different, and I go into that in the entries on them in the book. The Artists' Suffrage League were more fine art, and they were then lithograph posters, so quite glossy, printed by commercial publishers. But the Suffrage Atelier were more like, I don't know if you know, beggar staff type of poster printing from the late 1890s, very solid blocks of colour. And that was because some of them were amateurs, and they were taught how to print. They had the atelier was based out near Shepherd's Bush, and people would go there and they would spend evenings learning to print these posters, and then there would be a lot of them were hand coloured. So there was a different result. I mean, again, the book sets out these and shows you examples of their work.
Should we take one
one, two, three, four. Is that?
You mentioned, thank you very much for your talk, you mentioned that no artist damaged a painting, but I understand that Sylvia, in her account, she says she grubbed up a stone and threw it at a painting, but it bounced back.
Yes, it was in the House of Commons, wasn't it? Yeah. It was a painting of some politician. I was thinking of the ones in the galleries where they went in.
That's the only exception.
There was an amateur artist who did, Bertha Rylands, she did take a cleaver to something in the Birmingham Art Gallery, but I was saying these professional artists, but
Leaving aside Sylvia, were the artists actually paid for their work, or was it a free contribution to the cause?
Well, the Suffrage Atelier had set out quite explicitly in their manifesto that there would be payment for work, but whether they actually ever got anything, I don't know. I think the Artists' Suffrage League, they, for instance, they ran competitions, and so there would be a prize for the one that won, and then some of the other work might be used, but I don't think they were paid. If there was, it was very little anyway. Yes. So it was mainly doing it pro bono, really.
Oh, hello. My name's Yolande Yates, granddaughter of Rosalind Martine Yates, by the way. The cat and I wondered about the images for Very Bold Images Memorable for the cat and mouse postcard and Mrs. Pilkington and other postcards.
Yes,
were you able to identify all these artists?
Well, a lot of them are in the book, yes.
Good.
Alfred Pierce, who was the main cartoonist for Poets for Women, and I think he gave his work free, I think, and he produced a cartoon for every cover for years. He did a cat and mouse, that's a torturing women in prison. The cat and mouse one has never been really identified. It might have been by him, but I don't come to any conclusion that there's no... If things aren't signed, it's actually very difficult to identify it because there's really no primary material that tells you. I mean, in the scattered through all these newspapers, that's Women and Suffragette, but there's very little mention of who's actually doing the artwork or cartoons that aren't signed. So.
I think two last questions, one there and then one there.
I think that's going to be a question. In your opinion, which women do you think are missing in terms of documentation through via painting? As I'm a fine artist and painter based in Glasgow, and I've come down from Glasgow for this lecture. I'm very excited about this lecture. And my recent work has been based on Mary Barber, the lady who organised the rent strikes in Glasgow. And because of the etchings I made about her, we've actually built a monument in Govan, which was unveiled for International Women's Day the other week, in bronze based in Govan at last, only the fifth monument of a woman in the whole city. But as a painter myself, a lot of my work documents women who are around me who have not historically been documented, which frustrates me. For yourself, are there any women you wish were painted historically who lived, who you think are missing?
You mean portraits of paint? Yes, well, at least it's better to talking about portraits rather than statues. I mean, statues I hadn't actually turned my mind to it, really. Sort of very lame answer. Well, I have great favourites, whether they are in the suffrage movement, who are unregarded, whether one would see their portraits or their statue. Elizabeth Wusenholme Elmy is one of my favourites, but I'd certainly like to see her.
Hi. I'm also from Glasgow. I came down. I emailed you actually.
Yes,
I actually think I can answer a query you had about the Ferguson Gallery in Perth.
Oh yes, yes.
It's not actually held in Perth, the Suffrage collection. It's held at the Mitchell Library.
Oh yes, I know.
That's
yes. I know that. Yes,
but it's also not in English. It's in Scottish Gaelic, so unless you could
Margaret Morris papers, you mean?
Yeah, it's actually in Scottish Gaelic, and I am helping to organise an exhibition at the library for later on in the year, and I'm actually having to use my 8-year-old to... Unfortunately, I don't speak Gaelic, but she does.
Does this include material about Margaret Morris?
It includes absolutely everything. And when I say absolutely everything...
You've seen material of Margaret Morris?
I've seen... Literally, there is a room, not half the size of this, filled with everything you could possibly imagine.
Yes.
And it was donated by the Ferguson family.
Oh, I see. Oh, yes.
And it was donated simply, in fact, her niece, one of the nieces of the Ferguson family, is giving a talk tomorrow in the Mitchell, but it's actually all in Gaelic, and unless you can speak and read in it, unfortunately, you wouldn't know it. So if you've called and said, do you have that? They would say, well, no.
Unless you spoke it. Certainly was in correspondence with the archivists at Perth, who presumably have some material, because they could say that they didn't have anything. Well, there we are. This is opening. You see, as I say in the book, in the end of the introduction, I think of it, the idea is that once you do a book like this, it opens up fields, and people then start coming to you. I've already realised that one artist, Georgina Brackenbury, who I didn't know that where her work was extant, she did the portrait of Mrs. Pankhurst in the National Portrait Gallery, but it turns out that, not descendants, because again, unmarried women, but tangential family descendants, have quite a number of her portraits by her that they've got a small exhibition on at the moment. Yes, so just by producing the book, I'm sure that the material
the collection is pretty huge, and I've been working through it since January, and I'm only halfway. But luckily I have
and there is material about her involvement with the suffrage movement in it.
There are, so far I have seen Margaret Morris, so far.
Yeah.
I have also seen, I've got a little book here, I've got lots of highlights in it, yeah. Where I've noted down all the names that I've come across, and taken pictures and said to my daughter, can you please read this to me? She wants her name put on the helping list.
So thank you very much, Elizabeth, for a really fascinating talk, all the detective work, the years and years that have gone into this. Thank you all for coming, and also for contributing to the detective work. These libraries, I mean, both the one here and elsewhere, have been critical in retaining that history. We really need to acknowledge that. Please do use the collection, value it. It's here on your doorsteps. Do come over. Also, there's going to be some drinks, as mentioned earlier. And just lastly, applause and thanks to Elizabeth.